That's my topic today, and I added East Asian pop culture because to talk about inter-Asian love dramas, you need to understand the concept of pop culture, East Asian pop culture. Okay, so in this talk, let's see, I'm going to talk about the concept of East Asian pop culture, and of course, I want to approach East Asian pop culture through three aspects: the aspect of consumption, production, and textual negotiations, and then consumption. Okay. And in terms of context of production, I want to talk about industrial and political discourses in the dominant media, and with particular attention to the rise of China in East Asia and its impact on Taiwan. Okay, and then just to illustrate the concept of East Asian pop culture, I want to show a very small clip of Flowers Over Boys. The Flowers Over Boys is also called a media garden in Taiwan, and originally it's a comic strip from Japan. It's written by Kamio Yoko, and it's written from 1994 to 2004, and it was adapted into animation in Japan, but then it wasn't successful until the Taiwanese version, Taiwan adapted into Meteor Garden in 2001 and was a huge hit in East Asia. And then, of course, there's a sequel in 2002. Okay, and because of the success of Meteor Garden in Taiwan, and Japan made Boys Over Flowers, made it into trendy dramas in 2005, and then a sequel in 2007 and 2008. There's a movie about it. And in 2009, South Korea bought the copyright and then made it into Boys Over Flowers. You know, so you saw the clip there. And in 2009, China also made a version called Let's Watch the Meteor Shower. But then this version is based on Taiwan's meteor shower rather than the original Japanese version. Okay, so Meteor Garden, it's basically what I call, it crystallizes the concept of East Asian pop culture because of the mutual influencing between different countries, between Japan, Taiwan, South Korea, China. Okay, and it has the East Asian pop culture love formula, and that love formula from the clip we just saw. So it's about capitalist modernity, okay, and then the other is about Cinderella story. Okay, you have a poor girl who marries a rich man. Of course, there's always a love triangle there, with a woman having the choice between two men, having to make the choice. Anyway, that's really empowering for a lot of women. Anyway, okay, so the concept of, since the 1990s, with the popularity of Japanese dramas and followed by the Korean wave since the 2000s, a culture geography is formed through the production, consumption, circulation, and consumption of popular culture. Okay, so basically, East Asian pop culture is culture. It's a kind of culture geography. It's a geography made through cultural production, circulation, and consumption. Okay, and it's displacing the centrality of American culture in East Asia, even though American culture is still quite influential. But these days, you will see that East Asian pop culture is really displacing America. And within this cultural geography, it includes Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore and China. And the reason that Singapore is included is because many scholars have argued for the significance of Singapore as consumers in this cultural geography. And it's a realm of mutual influence and borrowing. And the conditions of possibilities for the formation of this East Asian pop culture include, first of all, the technological innovation. In the 90s, you have cable, you have satellite, VCD, and then later DVD. And of course, these days, you have internet streaming. Okay, and the second condition of possibility for the formation of this cultural geography is political liberalization. So in the late 80s, you have you have democratization, the end of authoritarian rule in Taiwan and South Korea. And so in the early 90s, the ban, because initially, before democratization, there's a ban on Japanese video and culture products. And in Taiwan, the ban on Japanese video and culture products were banned in 1993, as well as the legalization of cable. And therefore, you have many channels, many Japanese channels. And that initiated the Japanese wave or the craving or 哈日现象, the yearning or craving for Japan phenomenon. Okay, and the third condition of possibility is economic liberalization. And actually, I just mentioned this, the liberalization of the TV industry. So you have a lot of transnational corporation investment and also China also opened up in 1978. Okay, and then... And in terms of structure of East Asian pop culture, Japan and South Korea are positioned as the exporting countries, and I think they're still so. And Taiwan and Hong Kong stand in the middle. Singapore and China are positioned at the receiving end of pop culture, but I think the situation is beginning to change. This is scholar Chua Benhua. He argues that East Asian pop culture is it's basically built on existing pop culture China. So pop culture China incorporates Japan and Korea to become the larger East Asian pop culture. So basically what he says is that there's this historical culture geography called pop culture China, and then this historical culture geography incorporated Japan and South Korea. And pop culture China has existed since the 1920s, with Shaw Brothers playing a significant role for making films and music for ethnic Chinese in Singapore, Malaysia, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. And in the 60s and 70s, the center for pop culture China is Hong Kong. So you have a lot of Cantonese productions, and even in the 80s, early 80s too. But then the center has shifted to Taiwan because of its Mandarin production. But these days you have the rise of China as a large consumer market. So China is gaining a foothold in East Asian pop culture through the control and policing of content produced in Asia. Okay, and I want to argue that love dramas is central to the formation of East Asian pop culture. Without love dramas, I don't think there would be this culture geography. Okay, and because of the centrality of love dramas, therefore the role of women as well as gender politics are really significant here. And for this realm, in the early 1990s, you have Tokyo Love Stories, Long Vacation, And in 2000, you have the Korean Wave, Winter Sonata, Autumn in My Heart, and of course, the Hotelier, which is also my favorite. Mm-hmm. And since the 21st century, you have the Meteor Garden, and then you have Naughty Kiss, etc. You know, I mean, all these, throughout the whole decade. Okay, so this is Tokyo Love Story. And then this is Long Vacation with my favorite star, still favorite, Kimura Takuya. Oh, and then Bae Yongjin, his smile. Okay, and so now I want to talk about the context of production. And of course, we have to talk about Japan here. And Japan has been the mediator of Western modernity in Asia. So basically, Japan's role is sort of mediating, is taking American culture, hybridizes American culture, and then export it to East Asia. And that's because that is because of the history of colonization. So Japan basically used Western modernity to as its legitimacy for ruling. Japan colonized Taiwan and Korea. And after the Second World War, America also tried to build Japan as number two, second or next to America. Basically, by controlling Japan, and America can use Japan to control East Asia. I mean, that's America's political and economic strategy. And as a result, so Japan is also the mediator there, okay, after Second World War. And then in terms of post-war decolonization, Japanese language is banned in Taiwan and in South Korea. And also Japanese video and culture products are also banned in these two countries. But even with the banning of Japanese cultural products, you still have a lot of illegal exchanges between Japan and Taiwan, and also Japan and South Korea. Okay, and as a result of this, Japan has been the source of format, television format, and also content ideas for Taiwan and for South Korea, after Second War, since the invention of television until now. Okay, and for Japan, initially it was domestic audience that mattered. They don't really care about other audiences. And because they don't care about other audiences, there's no concern for intellectual property right. And as a result, there are a lot of pirated VCDs and DVDs. And I think this is also one of the reasons why there's this Japanese wave, because people can watch them illegally. Okay. However, things change after the Korean Wave. I think the Korean Wave has made people realize the significance of regional audiences, and that's what I call regionalization. And there are two discourses that motivate the search for regional audiences. These days, when you make a television drama, you don't make a television drama just for domestic audience, especially for Taiwan. Taiwan is such a small country, so basically they want to reach regional audiences, and for Korea too. They want to make dramas or films for regional audiences, okay? But the concept of regional audiences is quite a recent one. And so here I talk about two discourses that motivate the search for regional audiences. And the first discourse is the neoliberal definition of culture as economy. So you use culture to make profit, okay? And so East Asian countries view Korean pop culture as creative industry, which contributes to the increase of GDP. And all the countries explain the success of Korean dramas as the result of government intervention. And therefore, many East Asian countries begin to invest in creative industry just to increase GDP. Okay. And so here's a typical, I mean, this is a picture that illustrates the significance of pop culture as contributing to GDP. Okay, so here you have, you know, in 2000 and 2002, you have Winter Sonata, and so the GDP sort of rises anyway. And then you have Daejeongguin, and then the Ren, Girls' Generation. Anyway, so this graph just shows that shows the significance of pop culture. I mean, culture as economic resource. Okay. Okay, and the second discourse that motivated the search for regional audiences is the concept of pop culture as soft power. And the concept of soft power is initially proposed by Joseph Nye. He basically views culture. He views culture or as a form of political power. Okay, but this political power is defined as influence through culture or ideological means. In particular, in terms of cultural diplomacy, and Japan began to recognize soft power after Douglas McRae in 2002. Published this article and calls Japan's pop culture as national growth cool, okay? And that really catches Japanese government's attention. And so Japanese government begin to invest and intervene in culture industry, okay? And in terms of South Korea, because Winter Sonata was so popular, especially for Japanese women, the obasan, anyway, and so many women, middle-aged women, begin to learn Korean language and culture. And so for South Korean government, I mean, that's a form of cultural diplomacy, and people believe that pop culture or TV dramas have the power to mitigate, to reduce the hostilities and tensions between different countries. Okay, so that's the notion of popular diplomacy and its form of soft power. Okay, and in terms of China is unhappy with its cultural deficit, and as a result, China actively promotes traditional Chinese culture as its soft power through, on the one hand, government control of content, on the other hand, privatization of the TV industry. But that's sort of, these two are contradictory. And then, entering mainland China. So this is about South Korea, China, and Confucian values. Okay, South Korea views China as a large consumer market. Okay, and in South Korea, there are many discourses that try to explain why there is Korean wave. Okay, and one discourse is because they think that people like Korean wave is because of its Asian values. To be more specific, it's Confucian or Confucianism. And this is why Chinese people like Korean dramas. And it is because of the Asian values or Confucianism that initiated the Korean wave. Okay. And for South Korea, there's this discourse that tries to position South Korean culture as the stepping stone between China and the world. So basically, they acknowledge that, okay, China wants to be the world leader, okay, the world leader in terms of not only political economy, but also culture. And So South Korea acknowledges this ambition to position itself as the center of culture in the global village, and it proposes Korea to work with China to escape Korea's marginal position. And so there's this discourse about China-Korea alliance to counter Japan and Korea in order to be the world center. Okay, so this is Korea. And then in Taiwan's situation is much more complicated. Anyway, so I want to talk about the entering of mainland China and the hegemony of the Chinese language market in Taiwan. These days in Taiwan, everybody's talking about Chinese language market, 华语市场 or 华文市场 okay? And I think the hegemony of Chinese language market has to, can be explained through two factors. And the first factor is that in Taiwan,there's the entanglement of neoliberalization with democratization. So basically, when Taiwan began to democratize, okay, and because before democratization, the media is controlled by the KMT or the Nationalist Party, and democratization means privatization of the industry, okay? So in the...So in the realm of TV industry, the domination of the KMT, 外省 elite, 外省 means the people who came to Taiwan with Chiang Kai-shek. And these people, they basically dominate the TV industry. And, but democratization never really addressed this issue.Okay, but now with the privatization of the industry, basically what you have is the penetration of Chinese capital to Taiwan. Okay, controlling many television or controlling Taiwan's media.So media industries which promote pro-China agendas are financially supported by the Chinese state or the Chinese capital, more specifically Chinese capital, leading to the formation of a new patron-client dependency between pro-China capitalists and Chinese state.Okay. And the second factor that contributes to the hegemony of Chinese language market is with the loss of regime, the KMT, with the loss of regime in 2000, the KMT party has officially taken up the strategy of aligning with communist China to fight against the pro-independence DPP party, 联共制台独。In 2006, and the support of Channing winning presidential election in 2008 and 2012 meant that the KMT's significant agenda is to promote economic and cultural integration with China, and that results in the revisibility of traditional Chinese culture in education, business, and media. Okay.And here I want to talk about the political economy of traditional Chinese culture. And in terms of the politics of traditional Chinese culture, in 2008, Hu Jintao announces Hu Liu Dian, Hu 6 points, okay, as his policy guideline. And one of the guidelines include promoting Chinese culture and emphasizing its spiritual connection with Taiwan.Okay, and then in 2012, Xi Jinping, after he assumes power, he continues to use Chinese culture as a weapon for uniting Taiwan. So this is Xi Jinping's words. We hope people across the street can stay in solidarity and cooperate together in order to contribute to the recovery of Chinese culture and hence the Chinese nation.Okay, and this is the Minister of Culture from China, Cai Wu. He points out that we will continue to strengthen the cultural exchange across the strait, endorse the development and promotion of Chinese culture, and fortify the cooperation between the creative industries on both sides of the strait in order to increase their competitive edge in the world. So you see that traditional Chinese culture is used politically, okay? And then in terms of the economy, so this is from, this is from Chinese capitalist Liu Changle. I think it should be Liu Changde. Anyway, this is a director for Phoenix Media Corporation in China, and he is said to be a master who thinks from the perspective of all Chinese around the world. And he claims that, I think Taiwan has the great potential to be the dream factory for the Chinese in the world because of its rich experiences and great tradition.The best thing for Taiwan is to persist in promoting traditional Chinese culture. Taiwan should position itself as the foundation of traditional Chinese culture, using Chinese popular culture such as pop music and TV serial dramas as modern expression. Okay, so it's very clear that, you know, not only Chinese state, but also Chinese capitalists are promoting traditional Chinese culture through making dramas or popular music. And in terms of Taiwan, Taiwan's industrial discourses also promote traditional Chinese culture. And Chinese culture here is usually defined as a Confucian tradition. And it's constructed as a means for generating profit and crystallized into the business lingua of 华语市场, Chinese language market. And what binds together China and Taiwan through Chinese language market is traditional Chinese culture. And Taiwan is best equipped to sell traditional Chinese culture, not only because of it preserved Chinese culture, but also because it's more sophisticated than advanced media industry. So you see that this discourse, this way of talking is exactly the same as what the Chinese capitalists are talking. Okay, so this is a quote from Commonwealth magazine. I think this is a quote from Wang Weizong. He said that Taiwan's strength is its traditional Chinese culture with Taiwanese characteristics. It is its best niche in the world. We should keep this position in the Chinese world. This is Taiwanese producer's strength. Okay, and our Minister of Culture, Long Ying-tai, also says that Taiwan should use Chinese culture as our capital. Okay. Okay, so you see, so basically what I'm trying to illustrate is that traditional Chinese culture here is used for political as well as economic means. And both, and Chinese state, Taiwanese capitalists and Chinese capitalists are all working very hard to promote traditional Chinese culture. Okay. But what we have here is that the search for regional audiences, I mean, supposedly region, the concept of region should transcend the nation, right? And in business, there's the need to transcend national boundaries in order to search for regional audiences. But this kind of regionalism, from the quotes I just gave you, I mean, it's obviously not about regionalism. It is about nationalism. So interestingly, we have regionalism as nationalism here. So the dominant discourses imagine regionalism as formed through Confucianism in the name of Asian values or traditional Chinese culture. However, the concept of regionalism is only used instrumentally for national, political, or economic power. And that is, regionalism is a form of national power expansion. It's a form of nationalism. As a result, the concept of region inevitably meets resistance from other nations. Okay, and to illustrate regional as nationalism, I'll use the Korean discourse here as an example. So here is a quote from Korea, a Korea intellectual. He said, "The Korean wave is not only fighting back against the monopolistic position held by the American and Japanese culture in the Asian region. It's also demonstrating how Korean culture, which has been oppressed for over 5,000 years, can, using the cultural similarity between Asians and Asians' familiarity with Korean culture as its basis, spread throughout the world." So you see that regionalism, Korean wave regionalism, in fact, is a form of nationalism to fight against American and Japanese power, okay? So with this very weird concept of regionalism as nationalism, you see a lot of conflicts and tensions between nations. For example, in China, the Korean drama Jiumon, it's a historical drama, is banned because the Chinese think that it offers a negative portrayal of the Chinese dynasties and its inaccurate history. Okay. And so with this pop regionalism, what are its consequences? The first consequences is, as China is constructed as the largest market, And the tendency is for the industry, South Korea, Taiwan, and Hong Kong, to eliminate controversial issues that offend the Chinese state and nationalist, some nationalistic audiences. And the second is, especially for Hong Kong and Taiwan, you have very small market, and as a result, many of the talents in Taiwan, TV workers or media workers, they all move to China. And as a result, Taiwan and Hong Kong both faces the same problem, the decline of the cultural television industry. Okay. And I think the interesting part is Japan has a larger domestic market, and they don't really care about the Chinese audiences, or to be more specific, because Chinese don't watch or boycott Japanese product. So it's, in a way, useless for Japanese to care about Chinese audiences. And so interestingly, there are more genres that reflect local issues and concerns. And I think actually there's a revival of Japanese dramas these days. For example, you have Legal High, Hanzan wa Nayoki, and so on. I mean, these are all really popular these days. Okay, because people have been talking about the decline or the death of the Korean wave in 2000, okay, after the Korean wave. But actually, I think there's gonna be a revival here. Okay, and so now I want to move to the concept of text. So my question is, how is the acknowledgement of the Chinese market changes the textual strategies in love dramas in Taiwan? Okay, so to talk about this, I want to first talk about drama production for regional audiences. So here are some of the strategies that that TV industry use to reach regional audiences. And the first is, so like Meteor Garden or Flowers Over Boys, you have Japanese script, but with different adaptations in different countries. Okay, so you have Meteor Garden, Flowers Over Boys, and you have Naughty Kids, 恶作剧之吻, you have Sweet Relationship, 美味关系, you have, this is, can't pronounce it, Hanazakarina Kimitashini, okay, I forgot its Chinese name. You have Momo Love, Romantic Princess, Love Buffet. I mean, all these are based on Japanese script, but you have Korean adaptation, you have Taiwanese adaptation, okay, and the second strategy for reaching regional audiences, you have Japanese script, but it's co-produced by Japan, South Korea, Taiwan. For example, Skip Beat. Okay, so you have directors, actors, and actresses from three countries. And I think the most common strategy is internationalization of idols. So you have Korean idols in Taiwanese idol dramas in order to venture into the Chinese market. And so a newspaper said that it's a regular feature of drama production in Taiwan. So many dramas, love dramas, have Korean stars here. One example is 申请密码. And then the second is you have Korean stars in Chinese dramas. Okay, one example is 如果回到从前, if we could go back in time. And the third is you have Taiwanese idols in Japanese dramas, even though it's not very, it doesn't take off place very often. So one example is Moon Lover. Okay, and now I want to use two dramas to illustrate how the concept of Chinese market changes Taiwan's drama production. And okay.
所谓败犬, 泛指已过适婚年龄还是单身的女人。 即便她美丽又能干, 她生活OK, 品味绝佳, 她工作OK, 所向无敌。
小心, 小好。
只有在那一刻, 她觉得不太OK。 她单身, 但她拥有在雨中奔跑的勇气。 谁说单身就是败犬？在我心里，你是女王。
Okay, this drama is 败犬女王。Okay, I translated as loser dog queen. Its formal English name is called defeated queen. But I think defeated queen doesn't really translate, doesn't really says the concept of 败犬, loser dog. And the concept of loser dog actually comes from Japan. Okay, and it refers to single women. Okay, women who have reached their marriage age, but they haven't found a husband yet. And for women who are married, they call it 胜犬, winner dog. Okay, and so in the book, okay, let's see, okay. So it's from this book. And so in the book, the author basically says that single women who are capable and beautiful are considered loser dogs. And why they're beautiful? Because they have to make up for the fact that they are not married. And as a result, they are very fashionable, okay? So anyway, for this idol drama or love drama, the script ideas are borrowed from Japan and from two TV dramas. One is Around 40, and the other is Monster Parent. And of course, the concept of 败犬 is borrowed from the very popular bestseller, The Howls of Loser Dogs, 败犬的远飞. Okay. Okay, and so this is Around 40. Okay, it's about a professional woman who, anyway, she's reaching her marriage age, but she hasn't found a husband yet. And it's it's also about her sort of having to choose between an old love and a younger man. And of course, eventually she chose the younger man. But anyway, when she chose the younger man, she also faces the changes in her career. Okay, and so she's a psychiatrist, and she wants to be a good psychiatrist. She thinks that a hospital should devote to the well-being of the patients. A hospital shouldn't be just about earning money. So eventually, she just decides to pursue her career to build a human-centered or patient-centered hospital instead of a money-centered hospital. Okay, but in this show, it's not just about her. It's also about two other women's stories. Okay, and the other women, one of them is about a middle-aged woman. She wants to look for jobs, but then after being a housewife for such a long time, it's very difficult for her to find jobs. So it's about the process of it's about the difficulties of finding a job in Japan. Okay, and it's also about the unemployment situation in Japan because her husband was unemployed. Okay, so actually what I'm saying is that this show actually deals with a lot of social issues in Japan. Okay. And this is Monster Parent. Anyway, you have to notice that the hair, this is what we call the loser dog hair, 败犬发型. Okay, the Taiwanese loser dog, the 善无双, she also has the same hairstyle. Okay, anyway, this show is about a selfish lawyer. Anyway, she is very beautiful and strong and capable, but then she only cares about winning. Okay, but the show is about her transforming from a selfish lawyer to a good Japanese citizen. So eventually she sort of settles down as a legal consultant for elementary school. Okay, because she realizes that she has always wanted to devote herself to the good of the society. Okay, so So in the Japanese dramas, in around 40 and Monster Parent, okay, these stories are about the issues that contemporary Japan faces and issues that pertain to neoliberalism, the economic recession, economic situation, and also about women's status in the society. And I think these two shows, both Around 40 and Monster Parent, they are both about critiquing Japanese neoliberalism. They're critiquing the kind of business practice that only pursues profit only, okay? And so anyway, both of the shows, they express the idea of Japanese or human-centered capitalism through the figure of woman. So eventually you have these two protagonists, they both pursue their career, their love. And what is their love? Their love is about devoting themselves to the good of the society, to the patients. Okay. But in Taiwan, in the Loser Dog Queen in Taiwan, so Taiwan's love dramas or idol dramas, they target a single professional woman who have consuming power, and therefore the story about the middle-aged woman is eliminated, okay, and as well as the social and economic issues such as the difficulty of finding a job for middle-aged women and unemployment for middle-aged men. I mean, these social political issues are all eliminated in Taiwan's case, and also in Taiwan, there's no sense of national spirit, because I think for Japanese shows, they do express the kind of Japanese spirit, and the Japanese spirit is about the critique of Japanese neoliberalism. It's about searching for a better, a human-centered kind of capitalism. But Taiwan is a state without a nation, and it doesn't express any national spirit here. And so the show is purely about love, okay? So in terms of the politics of remediating Japanese dramas, and the focus in Taiwan's drama is about single professional woman and her having to choose between an old love, who is of course much more established, and a young man who is younger and less established. And so anyway, after about like 15 episodes of these two men sort of fighting each other. Anyway, the woman, Shan Wu Shuang, she chooses the younger man. And then later, the rest of the story is about the problem of this unconventional love, with a woman facing the ticking of her biological clock, but then the man is still not quite yet established. But at the end, I think it becomes a very traditional love story, because the young man decides to go to America to get his medical degree. And so in this case, when he comes back, he can be the breadwinner for the woman. And the heroine, she was such a strong woman and she was so capable, but then she decides to give up her dream, and that is the powerful chief editor position, but then not for the man, but in order to pursue a balanced life. So basically for the woman, I think this is the story about the taming of the woman. The woman is from the start a masculine woman, a capable woman. Okay, she's not masculine, but the fact that she's capable is considered masculine. And so she changes from a masculine woman to a real tender woman. Okay, and the man, of course, grows up, okay, from the protagonist's assistant to be a medical doctor, okay, who has a degree from the United States. Okay, but the interesting thing is the show actually offers an ambiguous ending. Okay, even though you think that they are going to be together, the protagonist and the the female protagonist and the younger man are going to be together, but there's no marriage there, okay? And I think the fact that there's no marriage ending and the possibility that there's no marriage ending, actually it offers possibility to subvert and reflect on existing gender politics in Taiwan. Okay, in Taiwan, we have a very high percentage of single women. Okay, so one third of women in Taiwan between the age of 30 to 40 are single. And because women do not want to get married if there's no Mr. Right. Okay. But what about China's responses? You know, in Taiwan, you make an idol drama. You want to sell it in China. Mm-hmm. But China bans this, to me, a very conservative show, even though it's an older woman and a young man. Okay, and the newspaper says that there are two reasons. And the first reason is that the content has bad influence on children. 内容教坏小孩. And I actually don't understand why 内容教坏小孩. But I think the second reason is actually the real reason. The production company, it's Sandy Production Company. Sandy produces a lot of idol dramas, anyway. And because Sandy is more on the green, the pro-independent side, and therefore the show was banned. And so the result, the director of Bai Quan Nu Wang, the director of Loser Dog Queen, Chen Yushan, she is called the godmother of Taiwanese idol dramas. 偶像剧教母, okay? So she goes to China to make Chinese dramas. And this is a quote from her. Chinese, have very good resources in China. I think we have to be very humble and learn how the market works. There are many genres in Taiwan. You can do whatever you want. But in China, there are many rules. I'm a creator, but I'm also a businesswoman. I need to learn how the audiences think and feel. I need to learn how to tailor to the market. Okay, so even with the rules, even the fact that you cannot make many shows, you can experiment different topics. But then it's a huge market there. Okay. And as for Sandy Station, so what do? They fire the most popular political host show, Zheng Hongyi. They fired him, and they cancels his show in order to sell their idol dramas. And also Sandy also changes the genre of idol drama, which is its forte, okay? They changes the genre of idol dramas to Chinese dramas, Hua Ju, in order to tailor to the Chinese audiences and claim to make the Chinese wave, okay? So this is their big, huge advertisement in newspaper. So it's Sandy Dianshi, they are gonna make the Chinese wave, okay? Hua Liu Lai Le. Okay, and the first drama that's called Hua Ji, the Chinese drama, is Inborn Pair. Okay, 真爱找麻烦. Okay, and it aims to create a Chinese wave. And okay, I will show a clip.
喧声在起浪，琴键在奔忙，聚光中你登场。
Okay, so how does this Hua Ju works in terms of textual negotiations, in terms of wanting to maintain its popular East idol drama formula, East Asian popular drama formula, and also the traditional Chinese culture, the Chinese market. So in terms of the proven love formula in East Asia, as I just as I said in the beginning, from the clip on Meteor Garden, so there's the capitalist modernity. Okay, so it's about an urban love story anywhere, you know, in East Asia as the background for easy identification and also for soliciting desire for consumption. And the second East Asian love formula is Cinderella story. You have a poor woman marries a young, handsome, tender billionaire who takes care of her. Okay, so So anyway, this one, okay. So she's from a more poor family, and he's of course a rich family. But here you see that now you have parents there, and even grandmother there. Okay. And that's not that typical in idol dramas. Okay. And so how does the concept of traditional Chinese culture work here? So here, there's an emphasis on traditional Chinese culture. So you have arranged marriage here. So these people, the male protagonist and the female protagonist, they didn't want to get married, but then it's an arranged marriage. And so in older, okay, so anyway, it started out as a fake marriage because they have to be obedient to the elderly. And after they got married, and then they began to know each other and finally fall in love, and therefore confirming the wisdom of the elderly. Okay, and the happy ending means that the woman gives birth to a son. Okay, and in fact, this is really, the ending is really, to me, ridiculous, because actually there are three plot lines, and then two minor plot lines. So two minor plot lines and the one major plot line. So you have three women. And at the end, all the three women give birth to children. And that really makes me wonder, I mean, why? Anyway. So here, the concept of family value is very important. So you have the concept of filial piety is much emphasized here. So all the members of the family have to be obedient to the grandmother. And so there's an emphasis on family hierarchy. And at the end, the woman, the female protagonist, she has always wanted to be a lawyer, but then she, of course, gives up her hope of becoming a lawyer and becomes a mom. Okay, so this is how they negotiate the successful East Asian formula with the so-called traditional Chinese culture. Okay, and so the consequences of this emphasis on traditional Chinese culture is that there's an elimination, the elimination of issues that are pertinent to contemporary Taiwanese women, such as strong women and less established men, or adultery, etc., etc. I mean, these issues cannot be dealt with. Okay, and then there's the revival of conservative patriarchal family values in dramas. And in Taiwan, so before this huge talk, anyway, there was an experiment with a variety of topics, and these are all very successful shows, such as The Fierce Wife, 犀利人妻, In Time With You, 可能不会爱你, My Queen, or Defeated Queen, 败权女王, okay. But now with the concept of Huariu, the Chinese wave or the Chinese drama, so what you have is a single focus on love within family dynamics to preach Confucian values. Okay, but the interesting thing is, just as I said, there's a comeback of Japanese dramas. So now Taiwan doesn't produce really interesting dramas, will consume Japanese dramas. And so, because Japanese dramas dealt with the social and economic issues caused by neoliberal globalization, and it really resonates with regional audiences, especially audiences in Taiwan. And so, Hanzang Nawa, Nayokin, Digo Hai, Amajang Dispatch, and so on, have become really, they were really popular in Taiwan. Okay, and so now I'll move on to the final aspect of consumption in East Asian pop culture. In the realm of consumption, many scholars, actually most of the scholarship actually focus on this field. And most people focus on the idea of an East Asian identity formed through the consumption of East Asian pop culture. Because if we consume popular culture, then these popular culture, they offer cultural resources, they offer languages for us to construct our identities. And because television dramas have enabled Asians to see and understand their neighbors, For example, Winter Sonata has enabled Japanese women to learn Korean languages and to study Korean history and so on. So many scholars want the possibility of a pan-East Asian cultural identity and hope that we can find this pan-East Asian identity through the consumption of TV dramas, okay? But, okay, and the reason for this desire to search for pan-East Asian cultural identity is because they want this identity to fight against a Western or American identity. So for a lot of people, it's considered a decolonizing move. Okay. But the problem is there are many obstacles to the formation of a pan-East Asian identity. And one obstacle is nationalism. So you have this Japanese comics, okay, the Xian Han Liu. Anyway, it's like hate Korean wave in Japan. Okay, and in Taiwan, okay, I will show this this rap. The song is called Cold Korean Han Liu, Cold Wave, Korean Wave. Okay. Mm. 是沒有,為什麼,可是打開電視的時候有看到電話滿多,看起來是那個很像中國,可是聽起來是那個,哎呀,還要,地怪,為什麼,韓國音樂你會買,還不是一樣,一雷天啊,我也打。Okay, the song is called The Invasion of the Korean Wave, and actually they staged this song in the rock concert in the concert when Bae Yong-jin came to Taiwan to promote his April Snow, his film April Snow. And so basically they changed the names to Swear Bae Yong-jin. Okay, and so here this is the lyrics. Okay, so when I come to Taiwan, I ask myself whether there's hip hop made in Taiwan for export. The answer is no, why? When I turn on television, there's various hip hop music, which looks like Chinese, but sounds like Enya Hasaya. Strange, why do you buy Korean music when it's just incomprehensible shit? Recently, I get colds easily because the Korean wave the sound is similar to cold wave, 寒流. It means cold wave. Okay. So recently, I get colds easily with runny noses because of the frequent invasion of the cold Korean wave. Taiwanese are fools. Korean singers in Taiwan earn easy money. Pop idol singers only need to have sunny smiles and charms like the boys from next door. Their lyrics are like farts. Tell me why you like them. Bae Yong-jin is not even half as handsome as Wu Bai. Wu Bai is the a rocker, the king of Taike. And then there's a lot of swearing. I don't think I can pronounce it here. Okay. And the interesting thing is they don't just swear Korean stars, they also swear Taiwanese stars and female stars. Yuki Ame, Coco Lee, okay. and of course, they swear at Taiwanese female audiences, okay. So what we have here is that you have male nationalism, these are called Taike. It's really complicated to explain Taike, but I'm just gonna simplify it. So anyway, they represent Taiwan. Okay, the Thai, they represent Taiwan. So you have these like Taiwanese male singers who represent Taiwan, who swear at women, okay, Taiwanese women who are after or who pursue Korean singers or Korean stars or Korean dramas, okay? But the reason that Taiwanese women love Korean dramas is because of the patriarchal culture. Because in Taiwan, they cannot get men's attention. They cannot they cannot have all the love from the men there. Therefore, they dream they pursue the dream that Korean love dramas offer. Okay. So this example shows that nationalism and gender politics, it gets in the way of the formation of a pan-East Asian cultural identity. And my second example is on class and gender consumption. So I interviewed two groups of Taiwanese women. One is the sort of middle class. They are well educated. They mostly have their BA and MA degrees. And the other group is at high school and even elementary school educated women, and both of them love Korean dramas. But the interesting thing is, so the working class women, they interpret Korean love dramas as offering good education to the young generation, because it places emphasis on filial piety and family values. These women keep telling me that, I mean, look at this woman. She is so filial. I mean, she does everything just to make the family more harmonious. Okay, and so for her, family harmony and also filial piety is very important. But for the well-educated women, very interestingly, they hate the good woman there. They identify with a bad woman, and they criticize Korean dramas for being very patriarchal, because they say that these Korean dramas always depict ambitious women as bad women. Okay, and so basically they offer a very good critique of patriarchal values in Korean dramas. Okay, but my approach is, so in Taiwan, okay, there are many interpretive repertoires or many cultural discourses circulating around, and we will take up some of the discourses that fits us. And when we take up these discourses, then we become a certain kind of person, okay? And that's what I call the identity formation. And in terms of gender discourses, in Taiwan, we have the gender equality discourse. And gender equality discourse is considered more modern, okay? And it's, you know, usually it's like well-educated woman who would take up more modern gender equality discourses. And so by taking up this kind of discourses, you actually construct yourself as a modern middle-class woman. But for the less educated women, they take up the filial piety discourse, which is a discourse promoted especially in the 60s. So it's considered a backward traditional discourse. But the reason that these women, they take up these discourses, because in Taiwan, you don't have very good system for the elderly. So you really have to rely on your children. If you are poor, you rely on your son, your children to support you. And therefore, it's important for them to emphasize this filial piety discourse. But the thing is, because discourses are hierarchically arranged, so you have the modern, the better gender equality discourses, and you have the backward traditional filial piety discourses. And by taking up this hierarchically arranged discourses, you actually become different class. You identify yourself as different classes of women, and that's the intersection of gender and class. Okay, I mean, by taking up modern discourses, you become a middle class woman, and by taking up this backward traditional discourses, you become traditional backward working class women. So in this case, even within Taiwan, you don't even have the same kind of identity. Okay, you have class divisions there.
Well, if they hate how women are portrayed, why do they watch it so much? Why do they like it?
Some people would just tell you that it's just entertainment. And some people would tell me that it's their, they look at their fashion. like how they dress, because Korean dramas usually offer good fashion direction. Okay. Okay, and so that's a politics of consumption. Consumption demonstrates the gender and class divisions within the nation as well as within the region. So in terms of gender and national politics, male Nan fans take on the symbolic police of the nation, demanding women to surrender to the masculine nationalism, with women looking for regional stars to compensate for their lack of love they experience in patriarchal societies. And in terms of class and gender, interpreting hierarchically arranged gender discourses constitute class identities, and hence the possibility of a pan-Asian or pan-East Asian identity through consumption pop culture is to be questioned. And there are possible communities formed through the consumption pop culture, but these communities tend to be fragmented and temporary. Okay, so my conclusion. So in terms of production, so you have globalization, regionalization produces the need to imagine regional audiences for profit. But as China rises, it has changed the dynamics of East Asian pop culture, and it's on the way to be the center due to its large market. And South Korea and Taiwan take on different strategies to collaborate with China, imagining themselves to be the stepping stone for China to be the center of the world. And what this means for Japan is still to be observed. But I think I'm getting more and more optimistic because of the recent shows there. And then in terms of texts, the emphasis on traditional Chinese culture actually leads to the conservative turn in terms of gender politics and depoliticization in Taiwanese love dramas. And in terms of consumption, I think there's the formation of an East Asian identity through consumption is quite unlikely. East Asia, despite capital's attempt at regionalization through production, is fragmented and divided. It is sometimes filled with intimacies and friendliness toward each other, but other times full of antagonisms and animosities as a result of histories of colonization, modernization, nationalism, and gender and class politics within the nation. Okay, so that's my talk today.